And good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
One more time. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Wonderful. Welcome to worship at First Christian Church Decatur, whether you are here in presence or all of your wonderful faces on this beautiful fall day, or whether you are at home watching this online, welcome. We're so glad that you are here. We'll start this morning with a poem for our theme. This is a poem from the wonderful poet Mary Oliver. Just a show of hands, how many people are familiar with Mary Oliver? Oh, pretty good, right?
Maybe half of us.
That's pretty good. Grandmother Mary is no longer in this world with us. She's been gone, I think, 2, maybe 3 years. This is one of her most famous poems. This is called In Black Water. Look, the trees are turning their own bodies into pillars of light. They're giving off the rich fragrance of cinnamon and fulfillment. The long tapers of the cattails are bursting and floating away over the blue shoulders of the ponds and every pond. No matter what its name is now nameless. Every year, everything I have ever learned in my lifetime leads back to this, the fires and the black river of loss, whose other side is salvation, whose meaning none of us will ever know. To live in this world, you must be able to do 3 things. Love what is mortal. To hold it against your bones, knowing that your life depends on it. And when the time comes, to let it go. You let it go. Let's join together in worship.
My name is Daniel Brower. I'm the associate pastor here at First Christian Church of Decatur.
Joining me in worship leadership this morning is, of course, the one, the only Adam Cole on the keys, William Garner, our music director, minister of music. All things music go through him. Our soloist this morning is the incomparable Allison Loridge. And our liturgist and elder this morning is the Reverend Antoine White Birch. I'm going to read for you this morning our welcome statement. It's found on the back of your bulletin. We do this every single Sunday, and yet I still don't know it by heart, so we're just going to do what I do. First Christian Church of Decatur, Disciples of Christ, is an open and affirming congregation. We welcome everyone into full participation in the life and membership of the church. Inspired and informed by God's love, mercy, and justice, we are purposefully involved in the healing and helping of our community and our world. We covenant with God and the greater community to nurture a spirit of love and service to neighbors, honor one another's differences, and fellowship in the breaking of the bread. Actively striving to honor each other's race, age, sexual orientation, gender identity, nationality, ethnicity, marital status, physical or mental ability, family configuration, political affiliation, economic circumstance, or theological perspective, we truly welcome all. We welcome everyone into full participation in the life and membership of the church. And to read more about the life of the church, take your bulletin and just go whoop like that, and there's your note. Today, after worship, is going to be our congregational listening session. We did a couple of those earlier in late summer, and they were incredibly beneficial, but we had to put a pause on them because of the so many church meetings that we then had to have. But now, we are done with meetings and we are back to listening. The session today will be facilitated by, I believe, the Reverend Dr. Barbara Sims King, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And we'll just gather up right after church right here in this space. So please stick around for that if you would like. As a note, you do not have to be a member of a church to stick around for that. I had a couple of people be like, well, I'd like to stay, but I'm not a member. And it doesn't matter. You're part of this congregation. You can stay if you want to stay. Also happening tonight is Youth Night at First Baptist Decatur. Their youth program is still going on super, super strong. So if you have any youth that you know that would like to go over there, they start at 6, and they are fed there, so you don't have to worry about dinner. I messed up the chalice thrift dates this week so, so bad. But it's still Thursday and Saturday, whatever the day number is. Chalice is going to be open this week. This Saturday is going to be our pop-up parking lot sale. It's like a littler version of our junk in the trunk sale. So please come out and support that. It's going to start at 10 and go till 3. And then last but certainly not least, the last thing I want to highlight is next Sunday, October 15th, is going to be 3 songwriters in concerts presented by Willow Music, our very own Adam Cole features, with 2 incredibly talented songwriter buddies of his. Adam, do you want to say anything more about that?
Sure, if you're interested. 7 of my original songs, 7 of each of their original songs, and we'll be doing them in a round. So, I mean, one after the other. So we'll be alternating our songs, and these are some of the best songwriters I've ever known in my life, and we're just really lucky to have them.
That's awesome. And I heard the rehearsal.
So please, please plan to attend that. That's going to be 3 p.m. in the sanctuary next Sunday. And sorry, I said that was the last thing. It's not. One last thing. Everybody has been asking, when are we going back to worship in the sanctuary? When are we going back to worship in the sanctuary?
The 22nd.
We will be back in the sanctuary on the 22nd, so please plan to attend worship that day. It's going to be significant. It's going to be emotional as we return home. But for now, we're all here, and we're all about to sing. Number 61, All Things Bright and Beautiful, for our opening hymn. Please stand as you are willing and able for our first hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
Oh,
the dreamers as well as the doubters.
Hear the warriors and wanderers and call on God by name.
Here in this time, we can remember all the ways God has graced us.
Here in these moments, we are reminded that God is with us always.
Here are gathered those daring enough to step out of comfort into the unknown.
Here in this safe space, we will find the courage to cry out, God save us in every situation.
In this morning unison prayer of invocation,
Resurrection God, thank you for the new life you give us today. Let us bring our whole selves to you, that you may gather us, body and soul, into your new kingdom. Let our community be a beacon of life and light and joy and justice in a world that threatens to overwhelm us. We praise you, we love you, and we ask these things of your Son's name.
Amen.
Transformed by the renewing of the mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the encourager in encouragement, the giver in sincerity, the leader in diligence, and the compassionate in cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We come now to the time in our service where we lift up the joys and concerns of our church and community with one another in fellowship. On the last page of your bulletin before you open it is the current prayer list. You can see there everyone that is listed. Is there anyone else that is not listed that we particularly lift up today?
Doral Service. People of the Middle East.
Yes, ma'am.
Leroy Jackson.
Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this time that we have together this morning. We thank you that even though it's getting a little chillier and it's getting a little tougher to get up in the morning, we still got up and we got here and we are here to pray to you and community with one another. God, we pray for all of those present, either physically or online right now. We thank you for their lives. We thank you for their presence. We thank you for the things that you have done and are doing in and through them. God, I ask you to continue to be with each and every one of us, not only this day, but every day going forward. We're entering a new season with new challenges, new changes. God, I ask you to be beside us throughout all of them. I mean, we know you are, always. But let us feel your spirit and your presence with us, even when things are difficult, when things are at their toughest and at their most joyful. Let us feel you beside us in each one of these circumstances. We praise you for the good things that you are doing in our lives. We thank you for those who come by the church every day, God. We thank you for those who visit us on Sunday. We thank you for those who are faithful to attend every event and every service. God, we thank you for new life. We thank you for Jamie Brewer Calvert. We thank you for the upcoming birth of baby Kasali. God, we pray your blessings on Shannon and Baraka as they prepare to welcome this new life to their world. God, we thank you so much for all of the blessings that you give us. And we thank you that we have the ability and the grace to, as we said in our call to worship, call you by name and ask even the creator of the universe to look into our lives and to heal and to bless us. God, we ask your healing blessings this morning on all those we have named. We lift up Russell Broomfield Branning, Kathy Foster, Dorel Service, Kevin Ruff, Leroy Jackson, Dean Thomas, and all of those who we have not said but we hold deeply in our hearts. God, we pray for those who are very near to us. We pray for those we've never even met. God, we pray for victims of injustice this morning, victims of natural disasters, victims of war. God, we particularly lift up the conflict in the Middle East right now. We ask that you place your hand there. Give wisdom and grace that wars may cease. God, thank you that you hear us. Even when we pray for big, difficult things, and even when we pray for small things that might feel insignificant, you hear us. And you answer us when we pray. So hear us now as we pray the prayer your Son taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise.
Something to do with where we are as individuals, as a congregation, maybe even as a larger community. So I want to say a little something about storytelling, just to refresh our memories about why would we tell stories in church? Well, one of the reasons we tell stories in church is because we are part of and living into the greatest story ever told, as that cliche goes. Hang on a second. Sorry. Yeah. There we go. Technical difficulty. So we are part of the greatest story ever told. One of the functions of our species seems to be telling stories. And I think that's a reflection of the image of God that is in us. The Talmud says, God loves stories. God loves stories. Everything that we see and hear and experience throughout the history of being human, of creation itself, which we're a part of, right, is God's story unfolding. Right? Yeah. So we seem to have a special place in that. The image of God has us, and out of us comes stories. We do other things too. We preach the praise. That's another topic for another storytelling session. So we tell stories because it's who we are. We tell stories because we realize through story how universal things are. When we hear a beautiful song, maybe all just remind you. Maybe all your
trials
are mercy in
disguise.
We all know that story, right? We all know that sometimes we discover, sometimes in the midst of things, sometimes many years, even decades later, that our trials are our mercies in disguise. So we tell stories in order to learn. We see how universal things are. Right? So, people often ask me, why don't you tell Christian stories? Well, I have and do tell Christian stories. I love the Abrahamic tradition and all the stories. It's so rich through Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. The storytelling is so rich. It's so beautiful. This particular story that I'm going to tell today, though, is not from that tradition. This is a story from the Lope region in West Africa. Now, we remember, before before there was nation building and colonialism and all that, there were regions in Africa, there were tribes in Africa, and they were organized around linguistic and cultural themes, right? Mm-hmm. There were no nations. So we're talking about sub-Saharan West Africa, Sierra Leone, Ghana, Nigeria. Okay, so we kind of have an idea of where we are. Right? And I want to tell this particular story and invite you all to listen in a particular way. Okay? We're going to have participation here at the end of the story. Okay? We're going to have participation here. So if you all don't have anything to say, I can stand up here for another day or two. Another talent. And you don't have to live with me, so thanks be to God. So where was I? Tell me where I was.
At the end, we're
going to
have to...
Oh, yes, audience participation. That's the big piece of what story has always been. Story is always about gathering the village together to remember. To remember. To remember. All right? So we're going to remember some things today through this story, through this telling of the story. Again, it's a West African story with an old Celtic guy in Southern America. You know, something good is going to happen there. That's just a great combination. What else should I say about this story before we start? Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is in a group, a class of stories that cultural anthropologists call dilemma stories. There's a dilemma in the story. And you all are going to be in the dilemma with the story and with me. And we'll see where that takes us. We'll see what information our ancestors may be trying to impart to us from the story about the transition we're in, both individually and collectively, right? We gather together to hear the story as a village, right? As a tribe, as a community of faith. So we'll invite the story into our space and see what it might stir up in us. Dilemma stories don't have right and wrong answers. They only have what happens inside of me when I hear one. Oh, well, I like that. I don't like that. But that person in the story was okay. Not so much that person. There are no right or wrong answers. There's only the invitation of the story to hear everyone's reaction, right? To hear everyone's sense of where this might have taken us and what it might mean for us. Does that make some sense? I'm getting some good looks and some like, what is he talking about? Which is a good thing too. So, the name of this story is The Lizard and the Fire. Does anyone know that story? The Lizard and the Fire. I should, credit where credit is due. I stole this story many, many years ago. I stole this story from Dr. Michael Mead. Michael is an amazing mythologist and a much better storyteller than I am, and drummer. He is out in Washington, and he was rummaging through an old bookstore one day and came across this book of old African tales that he had never heard. And he's been telling this one for a long time. You can go on YouTube and hear it done really well after this morning. It's called, that's what it was really about. But I do want to give Michael credit. He's a wonderful, crazy, delightful human being who utilizes ritual and storytelling and drumming in prisons and work with disadvantaged youth. And he's an incredible human being. Glad we made his acquaintance. Enough words, right? So once upon a time, right, that signals something to us, right? Once upon, not this time, or maybe this time, or maybe a time that was before this time, or after this time, or under this time, or over this time, different times, a time that may be beckoning to us. Anyway, it's a time before we stuck it up on the wall, right? In that other time, there was a chief of a tribe, the king, and he had a son. And the chief was watching the boy grow up, and one day he said to his son, "On the day you sleep with a maiden, that's the day you will die." So, he sent the boy deep into the bush to live alone. Now, many years went by. Much time went by, and the boy was becoming a young man. And what do you think? What do you think? One day, a maiden came walking through that part of the bush. And the maiden saw the young man, and the young man saw the maiden, and they started to talk. And aren't they having a wonderful time? And the maiden says, "I see that you are here all alone in the bush. I will come and visit you every day." And the young man says, "Oh no, 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 no. My father, the chief, the king, said, on the day I slept with a woman, that would be the day that I would die, as surely as a sword had passed through my heart." The maiden, she said, "Well, I will not come back and see you, for I do not wish to see you dead." The young man, he said, "No. No, no, you must come back. I cannot bear for you to go away." And she said, "All right, then I will come back. And maybe if you die, you won't stay dead." So, the very next day, she came back to where the young man was living, deep in the bush. And maidens and young men being what they are, they slept together. What do you suppose happened next? That's right, the boy died. Just like his father said he would. The boy died. And his father, the king, he wept. And his mother, the queen, she wept. And the villagers, they wept for the king's son. The maiden, she wept. And she went deep into the bush, deeper into the bush to find the old hunter. And when she had found the old hunter, she told the old hunter everything that had happened. And the old hunter said, "This is not a problem. All we need is a lizard and a fire." So the boy's body was brought back to the village, and a huge mound of wood was gathered. And it was lit, and those flames grew huge and hot. And the old hunter said, "Now, here is the situation we are in now." Do note that "now" is said twice. "Now, here is the situation that we are in now. this boy is dead. I will take this lizard, and I will throw this lizard into the fire. If someone can bring the lizard out alive, the boy will live again. And into the fire goes the lizard. And the king, his father, he tried to get to the lizard in the fire. But he could not because the flames were huge and hot. And the boy's mother, the queen, she tried to get to the lizard, but the flames were huge and hot and drove her back. The maiden, she jumped into the center of the fire and came out with the lizard, and the lizard was alive. And the boy, the young man, the chief's son, he came back to life too. Then the old hunter said this, "Now here is the situation we are in. Now here is the situation we are in now. This boy is back in life. This young man lives again. If he kills the lizard, the maiden will live, but his mother dies. If he lets the lizard live, then his mother gets to live. But the maiden dies. You got it? If we kill the lizard, the mother dies and the maiden gets to live. If we let the lizard live, the mother lives and the maiden dies. And the question in front of us now is, what are you going to do? What would you do?
Don't kill the lizard.
Why? Don't kill the lizard. Why? Why, Tom?
Well, maybe no one would die that way.
No.
No.
That wasn't the option.
You kill the lizard.
Oh, that's right. Missed it. Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you kill the lizard, here. Who would volunteer to die? Is that right?
Yeah.
No one else. Too stunning a story, too short a conversation.
Is the fire still going? Is that an option?
The fire's going.
It's the guy who has to decide he can get back in the fire.
The young man?
Yeah.
He could just say.
Right. Yeah, I didn't want this.
No thanks. I'll go.
Yeah.
This is a little like the Solomon story, right? Which is another dilemma story, right? We'll just split the baby in half, right? Every culture has dilemma stories. And they're not designed to teach us some moral lesson. This is the right thing to do. This is the wrong thing to do. They're designed to get our voices heard. Any more voices that need to be heard? Shall we kill the lizard? Or shall we let the lizard live?
If you let the lizard live, then two creatures live and one dies. So your balance is wide. If you let the lizard live, then two beings are alive and one is gone.
Right.
So your balance of life.
But the same is true also if you kill the lizard, right? So if you kill the lizard, you can't get off the horns of the dilemma that easy. If you kill the lizard, the mother dies, and the maiden gets to live.
Right. The lizard
does. But if you didn't say anything about what happens to the lizard.
Mother and the maiden and the lizard in a room.
Yeah. I have told this story literally hundreds of times, and every time I come to the punchline, it's always, are you going to get this right this time or not? If we kill the lizard, the mother dies, and the maiden gets to live. But if we let the lizard live, then the mother keeps on living, the maiden dies. So, any other?
Yeah,
very
good. If you're interested in population mixing, we could let the mother die because she probably no longer can have children or she has all she wants. And the maiden has the potential of producing children with somebody in the end.
Did y'all hear all that?
I'm stretching.
That makes perfect sense, right? So, how does that feel to everybody? All the mothers that have done all the sacrificing over the years, how does that feel? Yeah, I see a few hands, a few people getting anxious. How does that feel? Yeah. I told this story at a therapist conference once, and several times, but this particular time I told one woman was just completely incensed. You know, wanted to take it out on me too. It's okay, I understand. Probably had it coming. Didn't know mom. But that it can bring up that righteous sense of all the sacrifice. And after all the sacrifice, I have to die. We don't go on, right? We don't procreate, right? You see, there is no answer to this, right? There is no answer to what we should do as a tribe.
Yes, ma'am. And I was just going to say, in that regard, it has to be the mother to make the sacrifice. Like the tribe can't say, we're going to sacrifice you, mother. I mean, because it does keep the king's family and genetics and all that alive, but it has to be her that can make the sacrifice, because otherwise it's just, you know what I mean, for them to sacrifice her.
She has to ascend.
Yeah.
Give consent.
Or the maiden has. I mean, one of them has to decide to be the sacrifice, because otherwise it's icky.
And as somebody almost always says during storytelling, especially these kinds of stories, can't we just have another story? Or why does there always have to be all this killing?
Or lizard.
Why is that? Okay, I'm going to ask one other thing, and then we'll wrap it up here. What'd you think of the old hunter? What'd you think about the old hunter?
I don't like him.
did I say it was him?
Ooh. Oh,
I might have. The story is, it's just like singing. And the note is right there, but sometimes it's a little over here. Sometimes I say he, and I don't remember, but I didn't this time, did I? Did I say the hunter was a he? Yeah, all go home. That's the homework. Everybody go home and watch. That's the rewind.
Right. I was trying to figure out.
Say more, though, about the hunter.
There's a no win scenario here. Nobody's going to win. He's set up.
That's an interesting choice of words, too, right? Win. Right? We want solutions. We live in that sort of culture. We want solution rather than relatedness. Yeah, the mother wants to sacrifice herself. That's one thing. But if some guy or gal comes out of the woods and is supposed to know something, and obviously something pretty amazing happened here, right? So the old hunter knows something. Right? All this dying, all this killing, all this, yeah. And what do we think about the person who brings that? So
So this brings us to transitions. And what has to pass away? What has to die? I've been thinking about James a lot lately, with Jamie on the radar, you know, it's just impossible not to, And it would have been interesting to see what would have happened if we had another 25 years, James. Or maybe if that pastorate had only lasted 5 years, which is the average pastorate, by the way. So there are certain things, like the dilemma story, that we are not in control of, and we don't like that. And these times remind us of that. What we can have, and what you guys just did an awfully good job, I get a lot more arguments out of therapists than you. Therapists are one of them. Could have been worse. It could have been a room full of professors, probably. But I don't know if that's worse or not. Because the therapists want to get in your motivation. We do have honoring and listening to one another. And the invitation of the story, the invitation of the situation that we find ourselves in now, is an invitation for us to be clear and honest and servant and heartful about what is going on with us and what we might like to see come next. And to do that with great love, like jumping in the fire to retrieve a lizard so someone can live again. All power to the Creator and to His Son and to the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
And now our communion hymn, page 265, or the lyrics are printed in your bulletin. Spirit of God, descend upon my heart.
Thank you.
think stewardship is about giving thanks. Do I have a thankful heart? Do I live from a thankful heart? Do I live in gratitude? Which is a little different than counting one's blessings. I just found that a little pedantic, actually. But living from gratitude is a certain openness. It's an acknowledgement that all that I have has been given to me. And it's up to me whether I am open with that or whether I cling to that. So I want to give thanks this morning as our stewardship reflection. I want to give thanks. I want to give thanks for all of you, for your time and your talents and the treasure that you bring. If you are desirous of being part of that in a treasure-oriented way, if the bond market hasn't completely freaked you out, we have a box on the entryway table. You can leave your contribution. We can do that online as well at disciples.org. I want to give thanks to our ministry partners, Atlanta Council, all the 12-step groups that meet here, Jewish Kids Group, Atlanta Science Festival, Stand Up for Kids, Tater Makers. Great story about that. The guy that manages the building, the apartment building we're in. He said, you go to that church over there? I go over there to Decatur Makers to work with. Unity Fellowship, Gentle Spirit Fellowship, Sustaining International Sisters. Time, talents, treasures. Thanks. Share with you another piece of poetry. This is actually prose, and it's a poet that I don't know very well. I know Mary Oliver. I feel like Mary's my grandmother. This is a poet that I stumbled across a few years ago called Raving Bits. Isn't that a great name for a poet? Raving Bits. Don't know anything about he or she. Again, I don't know if Raving Bits is a woman or a man or any combination thereof. But this is a very powerful poem, piece of prose, actually, about this table and her personal trauma and how those are weaved together. Because I believe that's the story each of us and collectively we are telling when we come to this table. So she starts with a little warning about her writing. Fortunately, there's no cursing in this one, so we're in pretty good shape. But she does have a caveat, and here it is. Warning. There are allusions to a very sacred story in the poem you are about to hear. I am not suffering delusions of holiness. God, that's a great one. I am not suffering delusions of holiness. I just really adore. I really adore how the story parallels a transformation in my life. I intend no blasphemy, but it might have snuck in. Also, it follows no known recognizable poetic form. But it's not really legit prose either, so let's call it art. Like all life. Let's call it art. And here's your prose. Long ago, I once sat in celebration of this glorious existence. My best friends, my family, all of us at a mystical supper. As several of us understood that I was soon to be tortured and sacrificed. Dear Lambs, I feel that I gave myself over for you, so you can go forth with the others. Ever felt like that? We were talking about the mothers. I feel that I gave myself over for you, so you can go forth with the others. They need you now. Speak of me. I will persist. I will come back for you. We sat blissfully, oldest of companions. Note that there are 12. There are 12 companions. Familiar faith, sweet hope, careful remembrance, sly temperance, solid strength, tenuous fear, durable will, brave constance, shrewd jealousy, worthy honor, insightful knowledge, and my very dearest, devotion. On that night, I was betrayed, and shortly after, I was slain. And then, a miracle. I return from a dark place so that we may now rejoice and more fittingly honor this glorious and unique existence for the significance of its begetting you, me, we. Darling, darling, I long to wash our feet of this arduous journey. I long for us to confess our transgressions to one another and offer that as pure sacrifice to a stable and reconciled, more powerful we. I'm going to read that one more time. Darling, I long to wash our feet on this arduous journey. I long for us to confess our transgressions to one another and offer that as pure sacrifice to a stable and reconciled and more powerful we. You and she are not we. She and me are not we. You and I are not we alone, nor am I. Those to share in this shall be carefully chosen, for whoever should partake, if unworthy, is guilty of an audacious sacrilege. Give not that which is holy to the dogs. At supper now and always, know that we are substantially present. I food, you drink, and the vast universe can find everlasting nourishment and health in our loving bond. It is not a symbol. I want to say that again. It is not a symbol. I know that I have changed the physical substance of myself into that of a larger and more wonderful being. Much like a pail of water is changed into a brightly blue morning glory, yet philosophically retains all the accidental trappings of a pail of water. On that night, I was betrayed. And shortly after, I was slain. And then, a miracle. Now, every single day and every single night, I break my body for you, and you shall render fluid. I have given thanks for it, and I share it. And as we take this, please do this in remembrance of we. And then, more miracles to come. And then.
Let us pray. Oh God, we ask that you, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, bless and sanctify this bread and this wine to the souls of those who will receive it, that we may eat and drink in remembrance of your body and your blood. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name, we witness and we pray. Amen.
Amen.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said,
"This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way also the cup after supper, saying,
"This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you remember the Lord until he comes. Table's ready. Come and eat. Thank you.
Let us pray. God, our help,
we thank you for this supper, shared in the Spirit with your Son, Jesus, who makes us new and strong, who brings us life eternal. We praise you for giving us all good gifts in him, and pledge ourselves to serve you, even as in Christ you have served us.
Amen. And the closing hymn is my actual favorite hymn. Here I Am, Lord, hymn number 452.
Please stand to your willing name.
Finest bread I will provide.
May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep away all evil. May the Lord lead us all to eternal life. Amen.